But your physicians have expressed the charge that I should get upset me from your bed. But maybe you should revive your malady and fix yourself together, wretched sinner. He rest the servants, lady love and all.
Well, not to fall back into my dreams again, I'll tarry in spite of flesh and blood.
Your honour, sirs, hearing your amendment have come to play at present comedy. For so your doctors hold it very neat to frame your mind to mirth and merriment, which bars a thousand harms and lengthens life.
Well, come on, madam wife, and sit by my side, and we'll see what the merry players have to drink. Perhaps a lord who drinks in a tinkle.
Well, that just finished that part of the story. He just went on to great things. Leaving Sly forever in his dream. It was a dreamlike time for all of us. The Armada had been blown to the four winds, theatre was flourishing, and we were establishing London with the Queen's Men, competing with other companies like the Admiral's Men, set up by Lord Admiral Howard, who commanded our fleet against the Armada. It was a risky occupation. The slaves often put pay for our business, and our troops were falling behind. Will, we've got to face it. The Queen's Men is not the troop it used to be. If I had not kept that grocery off for me, I would have two groats for us together. Now try to get married.
Married?
We've got to throw in our lot with another company.
The Queen's Men's been good to us.
Yes, they have. But if it wasn't for your place, they'd have gone down here a long time ago.
Admiral's Men have got some fine actors.
Yes, but I don't trust that sharp dealer Philip Henslow that runs them. He pays his actor a figure, he packs his place together by half a dozen writers, and none of them know what they're supposed to be paid.
Indeed. And it makes a nonsense of the plays, in case you haven't noticed. But what's the alternative?
The Lord Chamberlain's men. They're closer to the Queen, we get more business from the court.
She'll be telling us what to write next.
Well, two incomes is better than one. We do need more pay.
Oh, you tried me too hard. I've been writing all night.
Well, you tell me you can't sleep anyway. What are you picking up for now?
Julius Caesar. The breakdown of order in the ancient republic. The nightmare of dictatorship and civil war.
Is that a good idea?
Imagine. Dawn in ancient Rome. Caesar rises to go to the capital, where Mark Antony intends to crown him king. Brutus and others are plotting to kill him, to prevent his coronation and preserve Rome's freedom.
Our next performance might be dangling from town hall if you put assassination on the stage. What is?
I'm for reason, not treason.
Well, a master of the rebels doesn't necessarily make such fine distinctions.
I put dangerous thoughts in the mouths of villains and madmen.
Oh, why didn't I just stick with grocery?
Because this makes you happy. You're looking bright. How are you getting on with the widow now?
Oh, very well. Very well, widow now. She agreed to marry me.
So that's it. A wedding bell for widow now.
I was never lonely again. Before the year was out, Becky and I were married, and she was pregnant too. In fact, over the next few years, she was more often pregnant than not. Before I knew it, the house rattled and squealed with children of all shapes and sizes. I did have to keep the grocery going. But the Lord Chamberlain's men flourished too, thanks to Will's extraordinary insomniac imagination. Sometimes I think he never slept at all, just went to the trance with a quill in his hand.
Weary with toil, I hasten to my bed. The dear repose for limbs with travel tired. There begins a journey in my head to work my mind when body's works expire.
What mean you, Caesar? We can no more for. I have your mouth to be at peace tonight. You shall not stir out of your house today.
Thrice did you in your sleep cry out, "Help, ho, they murder Caesar." Who's within?
My lord.
Go. Did the priesthood present sacrifice and bring me their opinions of success. Yet Caesar shall fall. For the things that threatened me ne'er looked but on my back. When they shall see the face of Caesar, they are vanished.
Caesar, I never stood on ceremonies, yet now they fly me. And there's one more thing, besides the things that we have heard and seen, we count most horrid sights seen by the watch. A lioness has well within the streets, and graves have yawned and yielded up their dead. Fair fiery warriors fought upon the clouds in ranks and squadrons, and bright forms of war which drizzled blood upon the capital. The noise of battle hurtled in the air. Horses did shriek and dying men did groan, and ghosts did shriek and squeal about the streets. Oh, Caesar, these things are beyond all reason. I do fear them.
What can be avoided whose end is purposed by the mighty gods? Yet Caesar shall go forth, for these things are to the world in general as to Caesar.
On beggar's side there are no comets seen. The heavens themselves blaze forth the death of princes.
Cowards die many times before their death. The valiant never taste of death but once. Of all the wonders that I have yet heard, it seems to me most strange that men should fear, seeing that death, a necessary end, will come when it will come.
What say the orders?
They will not have you stir forth today. Plucking the entrails of an offering forth, they could not find a heart within the leaf.
The gods do this in shame of cowardice. Caesar shall be a beast without a heart if he should stay at home today for fear. No, Caesar will not. Danger knows full well that Caesar is more dangerous than he. We are two lions littered in one day, and I the elder and more terrible.
Alas, my lord, your wisdom is consumed in confidence. Do not go forth today. Call it my fear that keeps you in the house and not your own. We'll send Mark Antony to the senate house, and he shall say you are not well today.
Mark Antony shall say I am not well. And for thy humour, I will stay alone.
Caesar, good morrow. All Caesar, good hail. I come to fetch you to the Senate House.
And you are come in very happy time to bear my greetings to the senators and tell them that I will not come today. Coward is false, and that I dare not falser. I will not come today, tell them so, Theseus.
Say he is sick.
Shall Caesar send a lie? Have I in conquest stretched my arms so far as to be afeard to tell Gradius the truth? Theseus, go tell them Caesar will not come.
Mighty Caesar, let me know some cause, lest there be laughed at.
But cause peace be in my will. I will not come, that is enough to satisfy the Senate. Because I love you, I will let you know. Calpurnia here, my wife, stays me at home.
I dreamt last night I saw his statue, which, like a fountain, with 100 spouts, did run pure blood, and many lusty Romans came smiling and did bathe their hands in it. These are surely warnings and portents of evils imminent, and on my knee I beg that he will stay at home today.
This dream is all a misinterpreted. It was a vision fair and fortunate. Your statue, spout in vain so many times, in which so many Romans bathe, is a vision that signifies that from you, great Romans shall suck reviving blood, and great men shall crest the stains, relics, tinctures, and cognizance. This, by Calpurnia's dream, signifies.
And this way have you well expounded it.
I have. When you have heard what I can say, the Senate has concluded this day to give a crown to mighty Caesar. If you shall send word you will not come, their minds may change. Besides, it will be a mock act to be rendered for someone to say, break up the Senate till another time, when Caesar's wife shall meet with better dreams. If Caesar shall hide himself, shall they not say, Lo, Caesar is praying? Pardon me, Caesar, for my dear love, for your proceedings forbid me to tell you this.
How foolish your fear seem now, Captain. I am ashamed that I did yield.
Caesar!
Give me my robe, for I will go. And look, where Publius is come to fetch me. Welcome, Publius. What, Brutus? Are you stirred so early too? Good morrow, Casca. Caius Legarius, Caesar was ne'er so much your enemy as that same ague which hath made you leave. What is still clock?
Caesar is drunken eight.
I thank you for your pains and courtesies. See, Antony, that revels long the nights is notwithstanding up. Good morrow, Antony. I am to blame to be thus waited for. Now, Cinna? Now, Metellus?
What is this? I have an hour's talk in store for you. Remember that you call on me today, beaming anew, that I may remember you.
Caesar, I will. And so near will I be, your best friend will wish I'd been fair.
Good friends. We'll straightway go together.
The assassination of Caesar could not prevent the collapse of the Roman Republic. Democracy was extinguished for 1600 years. I wonder if we'll ever see it again. As for us, we see not one nightmare, the Armada, but the other, the plague still stalks us. Becky and I lost our beloved little Jacob and Elizabeth. And when Will went home one Easter, he found that the merciless pestilence had Dr. Stratford before him and claimed the life of his only son, Hamlet, aged 11. Anne was inconsolable. Will had been writing another play for us, King John, mocking and triumphing over the French again, which had gone down so well in the head of the village in the crowd. Suddenly he couldn't write at all. I held my breath. Had I landed well along dry? But no, the news returned. And as it returned, he found himself weeping for the sorrows of the French. His grief, of Anne's and ours, all flowed into the torment of Constance at the French court. The boy Prince Arthur. The French claimants to the English throne had just been captured by the English. And she thought already that the wind was dead.
So, by roaring tempest on the flood, a whole armada of convicted sailors scattered and disjoined from fellowship. But courage and comfort all surely have gone well.
What can go well when we run so ill? Are we not beaten? And dear lost, poor Arthur taken, and Diver's dear friend slain, and England under bloody England gone.
Patience, good lady. Courage, gentle Constance.
I will take no counsel, no regrets. Oh, death, death, oh, amiable, lovely death. Arise from the couch of lasting night, and I will kiss thy detestable bones, and stop this gap of death with fulsome dust. Come, grin, and I think thou smilest.
A fair affliction of peace.
Oh no, while I have breath to cry, I would that my tongue were in the mouth of thunder. And then with a passion I will shake the world!
Are you utter madness, not sorrow?